Yay! Woo!
And guys, how it all happened is because Chris, and Chris is on here too. So Chris connected us with Kay, connected us with David, and I don't know if a lot of you guys are in the book club, but Kay, she's been phenomenal. I wish you had on the Wolfen in the recording, and so that's how it all happened. Is so thank you so much, Chris. We are all connected. And I read this book the first time. I wrote that I was going to spread this knowledge in the Happy Pocket Full of Money, because I think we all know. And Lenny, you know, you chose this to be the book, not just once, but twice. You've never done that for a retreat. So I don't know if you want to speak on that for just a second, and then let's all listen to David. Did you want to speak on that at all, Lenny? Hold on, let me unmute you guys. I think you're muted. Hold on.
Gotcha.
Okay, there we go.
Okay, cool. I just really want to honor you, Casey, for the connection to David Kikandi. And we're just so grateful to have you, David. We love your work. We've been devouring it, total immersion for the whole weekend. And we just want you to speak from your heart and tell us what's going on. What do you want us to know? What's the message?
Okay, great. I'll do that. As soon as Casey lets me do it, she's the boss. She tells me what to do and what to do.
No, I was waiting. I'm just so honored. And again, I mean, Chris, you made it happen. And David, you're changing the world with this information. So I know that you're over in Africa right now. And I'd love technology. It's just so incredible. And your work, your new program on the subconscious is just so incredible. I'm just so excited to continue to learn from you and anything that's on your heart, or we can go through some questions that are in the group, but we're just all open vessels right now to hear whatever you have to say.
Okay. How long do I have? Do I just go and then you're going to tell me when to?
Yep. Pretty much.
Okay.
However long.
All right. Okay, good. And let me know if I'm too loud or too fast or too slow, whatever. I was wondering what I should talk about, because it's one of those subjects that is so wide yet so simple at the same time. And we are all learning. I'm learning too. Sometimes for the longest, I felt like that information and also the stuff in the subconscious module, really, sometimes it shocks me when I look back at it. It's just stuff that I guess what I want to say is that at the end of the day, I think the most important thing to realize is that it's just all boils down to one thing, vibration. Now, that sounds a bit crazy when you say vibration, because everyone is like, what does that mean? What does that mean? Well, if you look at your emotions, the emotions that you go through all day, I'm talking 24 hours a day, you know, we've all gone to courses and to events that tell us, you know, we need to visualize, we need to make vision boards and all that kind of stuff. And so we tend to think that maybe we should get up in the morning and just do a visualization session for 30 minutes and then one in the evening, and that's all we need. But what I've found out is that life itself, the whole of life, is actually, there isn't really much of a mystery to it. It has mechanics. It has a way that it works. So let me try and break down what I just said. Just to clarify what I mean. Now, I'm going to real quick go to quantum physics, and then I'm going to come back to what I said about vibration, and then I'm going to come back real quick to emotion and show you how they all connect. Because at the end of the day, to be honest, and that is all that matters. If any other happens about why some people get things and I don't get, all of that comes back down to one simple thing: your vibration and your emotions are the ones that are telling how you're vibrating. So if I can just real quick go to quantum physics, and the other day I saw a very interesting quote on some science website, and it say that, you know, the way we're about 7 billion people on this planet? Yeah, I think we're about 7 billion people, right? Right. Now, each person is made up of about 7 billion atoms, okay? That's what I'm made of, that's what you're made of. Everything that you see around you is a collection of atoms. There's not a single thing that you can think of that's not made of atoms, okay? I mean, throughout the day, you go throughout your day, you're surrounded by objects. Those objects could be anything. Could be the desk you're sitting on, the people you're interacting with, the events that happen to you. All of that stuff is built with atoms. That's the basic construction of life, okay? Now, the interesting thing about atoms, if you take any one atom, an atom, now this is pure science. This is not some metaphysical stuff. This is pure science. An atom is 99.99999, I don't know how many nines there are, space, okay? The rest of it, the physical stuff, you know, like you're looking at me, I'm looking at you guys, and it seems like there's some physical stuff. But when you look at it down to its most basic structure, you realize that most of everything that you see around you is space. Now, that's not what your eyes tell you, but when you look at it, and this is why I knew I'd get in a bit of trouble right now explaining this part, and that's why I thought I'll give you guys a video at the end of this. I'll give you one of the courses that you have, Casey, in the subconscious module. I'll give that free to everybody, because this is the most important basic part to get, that most all of life, 99.99% of life is just space. It's actually, there's nothing there. So what we call physical reality, what we can touch, we're all trying to manifest stuff. We're trying to manifest money, a good time, whatever it is we're trying to manifest, is actually energy that's flashing in and out of existence 50 billion times a second. Now, again, that number is we can't really prove that number, but it's billions of times a second. Now, we all know, science now has proven that life is literally a flashing field of energy. That's the foundation for everything that we're going to talk about from this point forward. Is that clear enough, or should I try and say it in a different way?
Good.
Is that okay? Okay. So now, where do I go from here? Okay, let's see where to take this from here. You know where I'm trying to end up is that at the end of the day, it's all about being yourself. The minute you're yourself, the minute you're just relaxed, the minute you're in the flow, things happen. So I'm trying to get to why things happen that way. Sorry, I should have written this down, but just give me a second. I need to sort of calm down here and find a way to say this. Okay. Now, as human... Sorry? Okay. As people, throughout the day, the thing to realize that 24/7, there is not a single time that you're not in vibration. There is not a single moment that you're not in vibration. What does that mean? Every time you're always thinking, even when you're sleeping, you're thinking of stuff. You're feeling things. In other words, what's happening is that you have a belief system that tells you who you think you are and what you think the world is, okay? That's called the self-view. Who you think you are or what you think you are and what you believe the world is, okay? Are we there yet? What you believe you are and what you believe the world is. Now, that is precisely what creates the whole of your reality. What you believe you are and what you believe the world is. That is a sum total of what's causing the vibration that is called David or Casey or anybody else. When you walk around town and you're Casey, you have an idea of what you believe you are, what you believe the world is. This belief system, what you believe you are, what you believe the world is the sum total of your 24/7 vibration, and that is what is interacting with this energy field that is just about everything that you see around you, and that is what is creating your reality. In other words, the reality around you is pretty much a reflection of what you believe you are, what you believe your world is. It's just a mirror image. It's just a way, like life was built like that, so we can know ourselves that way. So that's the next point. Is that clear enough, or should we?
Very clear.
Do we have any questions before we move on? Because this is such an important point. What you believe you are and what you believe the world is what is creating your 24/7 vibration. And that is what is creating your reality. more than the 20 minutes in the morning that you do for visualization, or more than the
Hold on, I've lost. Are you guys able to hear?
No. Come back. We're all sweating in blood right now.
That's the name of the program. Pretty remarkable for Africa, you know, like you think about technology and how.
On your way to work in your car. Sorry,
we lost you for a minute.
No.
That.
Throw them away.
Casey, if you could just repeat, what did you say that again?
We
hello?
Lost you, David. I think you're coming back though.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I just wanted to ask if there's any question, because in the last couple of years, the one thing that I've found to be the most important thing when it comes to manifesting your reality is what you believe you are and what you believe the world is. That is what forms a vibration that is, let's say, like me, David. Whatever I think I am and whatever I think the world is, that sum total is what is always going to show up in my life as my reality. Precisely because of the way quantum physics works. It's a reflection of that belief system.
There was a question that Carrie had put in the group, and at the beginning of the call, you just said how, you know, vibration is the most important and it's based on our emotions.
Can yes.
Talk about like emotions and feelings, like just a little bit on that aspect. What's the difference between the emotion
okay.
and feeling was her question.
Okay, just real quick, vibration is not really based on our emotions. The emotions tell us what our vibration is.
Okay.
So the way I understand emotion is that it's energy in motion. The whole universe is just energy. When you feel yourself, when you feel happy, when you feel love, when you feel sadness, when you feel excited, when you feel fear, whatever it is that you're feeling, that's actually an energy current. And energy carries information. So the way you feel is a direct indicator of how you're vibrating. So if you feel, for example, you feel excited, okay, that's telling you that your vibrational system is in a place of excitement. And what it's going to attract, the way it's going to influence the quantum. Hello? Yeah, so the way, if you feel excited, if you feel excited, your emotional indicator telling you that your energy is in a state of excitement. And what happens is that then it attracts in the fact that you are in a place of excitement. In other words, life is always trying to prove to you that what you're feeling, what your belief system is, correct. That's the point of life. It's always a mirror image. It's always, it's kind of like, it was built for us to know ourselves. So if we can understand that that's what the point of life is that it's built for us to understand ourselves, then we can start to realize that what we need to do is simply to know ourselves better. So the way I define emotion is that the way I personally use emotion is, for example, I want to manifest something, maybe beyond what I expect that I can do, maybe whatever it is. And if I feel fear, what I do is that I don't try to make that fear disappear. What I do is first accept myself as I am, where I am today. So whatever it is that I'm feeling, I don't try to dodge. I first try to accept myself. But once you're in a place of acceptance, once you relax into wherever you are, then you can start to know yourself. You follow your emotional flow. That makes sense. Whatever it is you're feeling, follow that emotion. Let it, just relax into it. First, feel yourself. Don't try and dodge the emotion. Don't try and cover up the fear. ask, feel that fear, and then feel, where is the fear? How does it feel? Is it affecting me in my brain? What is it telling me? What is it whispering? What is it telling me that I am? What is it telling me that the world is? And once you start to follow your emotion, you start to see what you believe about yourself, what you believe about your world. And this starts to expose your belief system to you. Once you start to see your belief system, then you can actually change your belief system, because the only thing that can block a manifestation of anything is your beliefs. And the only way you can discover what your subconscious beliefs are is by following your emotions. Your emotions are always telling you two things. What do I believe about myself? What do I believe about the world? How am I vibrating? That's what the emotional system is always telling you. It's always a guidance system. It's always telling you, if you're going the right way, you're feeling good. If you're not going the right way and you're feeling bad, it'll tell you, why are you feeling bad? What am I thinking about myself? What am I thinking about the world?
Love that. And because I think, for at least I know for me, it's always wanting to just ignore the fear and not even, you know, as far as like, oh, fear, just ignore it. But you're saying follow it.
I say, first of all, relax into it. Just don't try to dodge. Don't try to, a lot of us have been told not to be emotionally vulnerable. We've been conditioned to, you know, man up, become macho, or don't feel fear. But as long as you keep doing this, you're just going to keep going back in the same cycle. You know, the same old fears come up, and then you try and overcome them by dodging them or somehow blocking them. And then maybe you succeed a little bit, nothing much changes. And next week, the same old fear comes back. So if you want to stop this cycle from happening, the way I've seen, what I found is the best way to stop this cycle happening is actually first to accept yourself as you are, where you are. Because it takes no time and no effort to accept yourself where you are. So if you're in fear, that's okay. Just first of all, stop and say, I'm afraid. Accept it. I'm afraid. Why am I afraid? Listen to your emotional system. Understand, what are you feeling about yourself? When you say, I'm afraid of doing something, what are you telling yourself about you? What are you telling yourself about the world? You know, are you telling yourself that maybe I'm not capable or I'm not acceptable? Okay, fine, accept that. Right now I'm telling myself I'm not acceptable. And then again, stop and watch. Whenever you stop and watch, you start becoming more and more aware of what's going on inside you. And the more you become aware, the more you see what's happening inside you, the more you become free of the gates or the boxes or the fences that you've built around your own self. Because the point is that 24/7 we're manifesting. Manifesting is not difficult. It's happening 24/7 because you're always in vibration. So the only job that we've got to do is not to try to manifest, but it is to discover what is within us that is actually creating the reality that we think we don't want, or maybe preventing us from getting the reality that we think we want. The manifestation is always happening. There's nothing, it's like now I'm talking. I don't know what I'm gonna say in the next 2 minutes, but I trust that once I open my mouth, something's gonna come out, and it's all going to like make some kind of a coherent sentence out of it. That's the same thing with manifesting. We don't have to put an effort to manifest. You are built to manifest. You're always manifesting 24/7. You see, so the point is not really to try to figure out tricks on how to make things happen. It is more to relax into who you are, so that you can start to better know, what are your subconscious belief systems? What do I think about me? Or what do I believe is true about me? What do I believe is true about life? Because the energy field, the way life is built, it's always going to come up and present to you things that reflect what you believe is true about you and about life. It's never going to like negate that. So, for example, I was talking with somebody the other day, and one topic that came up was about she was asking, why is it that some things take so long to manifest? Or maybe I put in so much effort and then the manifestation has such a small result. Why is that? And then we went back to, we said, okay, fine, just forget about what you're trying to manifest. Let's look at people who come from, let's say, broken families. Let's say, in fact, let's make it easy. Let's say somebody who comes from an alcoholic family, okay? Take a kid who was born in an alcoholic family. That kid grew up getting used to a certain level of, let's say, victimization, persecution and rescue. You know, they play that game in that alcoholic family. You know, there's always that game in every alcoholic family. You've got the persecutor, you've got the victim, and you've got the rescuer. And so for the longest number of years, this child, they automatically sort of adopted an idea that life is maybe not safe, and maybe they adopted the idea that they are not safe as well. Maybe they need to pretend or defend themselves in a certain way, and they're not accepted. This particular idea of themselves and of life, the only way they can figure out that that's what's bugging them now, let's say now they're 40 years old and they're trying to manifest something and it's not happening. Let's say manifest that which they're trying to do, but they first is for them. You know, don't try and manifest anything. First of all, try and figure out. Oh, can you hear me? Okay, the internet seems back. I just lost you for a while. Yeah. So this adult child of an alcoholic family, their manifestations will always keep proving to them whatever they decided as a child was true about them and was true about the world. And the only way they can get out of that cycle is for them to first stop, first listen to themselves, understand, what am I believing about me? What am I believing about life? And the only way to do that really is to first accept themselves where they are, as they are, with their fears, with their drama, without trying to fix it with money or trying to fix it with like manifestations. First, just stop, accept themselves. And once they do that, and once they follow their emotional system, and they really let their emotions talk to them and tell them, oh, you're telling yourself that you are a victim because of X, Y, Z. In this realization that this is what they're telling themselves about themselves, they will start to become free of that belief system. And then all of a sudden, the manifestations that they were trying to do that were failing before will start to happen. I don't know whether that makes sense to everybody.
Yes.
So, the message I wanted to bring to us here today is that there's a lot we can learn about, like, for example, the Happy Pocket Full of Money has so many chapters. It's got about 22 chapters on all sorts of different things. But if I can summarize that whole book down to one word, it'll be relax into who you are right now. First and foremost, don't try to manifest. First, relax into who you are right now. Once you relax into who you are, get an interest to know yourself. Know yourself. Why do I, for example, maybe a few years ago, I was frantic about manifesting money so I can move out of Kenya and X, Y, Z. And that wasn't working out because I was just desperate, right? And it's only when I sort of like slowed down and I accepted myself and I said, okay, this is who I am. Why do I want to escape? Okay, fine. Because I associate the way I define myself, I felt negative about myself because I was stuck in this country back then. You see, why do I do that? And then I feel how do I feel about that? And this is what started to make me realize what I believe about myself, what I believe about the world, what I believe are my limitations. It only happened when I stopped to listen to my emotions. And you have to become emotionally vulnerable. You cannot move forward until you allow yourself to feel absolutely everything. Because your emotions are always going to drive you to your belief systems. And once you get into your belief systems, you start to see what you believe about the world. Things that were hidden to you before, things that you call subconscious, are going to come up to the surface. And once they do, the minute you recognize a belief, the minute you see something, all of a sudden you're free of it. And then the manifestation that was probably giving you trouble for 20 years, all of a sudden happens in a second.
Yay. Did you guys want to ask anything or anything, Lenny? Anybody there?
Are we unmuted?
Yeah, you're unmuted. We can hear you.
I would just be the leader and keep asking questions.
All right, sounds good. As far as how you just talk about the emotions and, you know, just flowing into it and then allowing yourself to, you know, just relax into who you are, then that's what manifesting starts having instantly. I think we would love the example of your life. Like, what was it really that allowed you to shift? Like, what, could you just talk a little bit just about like your shift? Like, when, how you began to do that, and then what you started to come, like, an actual example for you?
Okay. All right. Let me first say that at the beginning, I did not know this. When I was writing the Happy Pocket Full of Money, I did not know that the importance of the emotional system. I had no idea. I knew that there must be a method to how life, money creates our reality. And that is what inspired me to go search for that answer. And in making those notes, that's how that book, Happy Pocket Full of Money, came up. It was really just, I was just inspired and led places. When that book came out, then I tried to practice directly. I tried to say, okay, fine, I'm just going to do 1,000 goals and I'm going to like chant about them and all that. And some of them just worked like that, no problem. But some of them gave me, you know, like 2, 3, 4 years of problems. They just never manifested. And I was thinking, why is that system broken? Then I got invited to do the Secret as well. And we did that and everybody went home. And I'm sure everybody tried doing the whole law of attraction thing and all that. And I tried it as well. And of course, many things happened. But still the same exact problems that I've been having kept on going on and on. And I started to think, what's going on? Why is this law of attraction not working for these particular things? I got like 2, 3, 4, 5 things that it was working for me. For example, I had an invisible ceiling to my income that I couldn't seem to penetrate. And I also seemed to have a floor that I couldn't seem to fall under. Yeah. So I seemed to have kind of like a place that I was bouncing between all the time. And I would never, for some reason, I would never fall through that, but I would never also penetrate this. And it's only when, basically, for the lack of a better word, I sort of stopped all the efforting and all the trying, and I just relaxed into it. And I said, you know what? I've tried for so many years. It's been working out. I'm just going to relax into it. And I can't remember what book I read, but it made me realize how important it is to know myself first and foremost. And I started to think, why do I really want to penetrate this ceiling? What is it that I'm trying to do? What is it that I'm trying to get? And or what is it that I'm trying to escape? And I realized that I had bound my identity on, okay, there we go. This is Africa. The path just went. Don't worry about it. So I realized that I had bound my identity to how much material stuff that I had. And I felt not good about myself when I had very little things materially. And I thought that I would feel better about myself if I had more material things, okay? And so I was trying to sort of run away from myself, yeah? That's the whole point I'm getting at here. I was trying to run away from myself and I was trying to manifest things so I can rescue myself from not feeling bad about myself. You see what I mean? And the minute I realized how to accept myself as I am and I stopped being needy about getting all these things, and I realized that my value came from just being a human being, and I didn't need to have all this stuff to be good about, you know, to be a worthwhile human being. You know, these are ideas I got from growing up in a third world country with a dictator. So, you know, I just felt like, oh, you know, poor me, I was born in a third world country with this crazy dictator. We don't even have a can of Coke here, you know? So I realized my you as a human being, just as I was, and I did that because I stopped all the efforting and trying to escape and trying to cut myself with material things so I could be better about myself. My emotions are the ones that made me realize, oh my God, I feel so terrible about me. Why do I feel terrible about me? Oh, because I think I'm crap unless I got this. And that's the journey that took me into knowing who I really was and then accepting myself as I was. And the minute I did that, the minute I felt, oh my God, Dave, I love you unconditionally. You're so cool. You're fine. That's tough. Don't worry about it. Or whatever it was. Of course, like, you know, it's a longer story than that. But as soon as I realized that, all of a sudden, the floodgates opened. So that's the probably the biggest example I can give you. There are many other little ones that I can give you, but I hope that's a good example. I don't know whether that was a good example.
That's perfect. Also, a lot of people asked about self-sabotage, like self-sabotaging themselves and just belief. Like if you could just touch on self-sabotage and lack of belief, I think that could assist.
The easiest way for me to explain this is, look at a wild horse, yeah? You know, we've all seen wild horses just running around, having a good old time, and then, you know, a cowboy comes along and gets a whole bunch of them and then, you know, just tries to herd them into a corral. Once they're in the corral, they're locked up and, they're really frantic. They just want to get out of there. And then the cowboy walks in there and actually has to break the horses. It's called breaking the horses. And finally, the horse becomes tame, okay? Now, the crazy thing that happens is that when you open that the corral, the gate, that horse that used to be a wild horse, a nice tame, it may walk out, but as soon as it walks out a little bit of a distance, it just thinks, this doesn't look so safe. It goes back into its own cage by itself. See what I mean? So when you talk about sabotage, the way I look at it is that we get used to a sense of self and a sense of the world that makes us feel safe because that's what we've become accustomed to for many, 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 many years, okay? So as soon as we try and do something that gets us out of that thing that we've become used to, it's like a magnet, we just go back, we just kind of go back in the most crazy way. Like, for example, it used to happen to me. Let's say I'm starting a new business, for example, back in the days. I would get everything lined up, all the ducks lined up and everything was just going good. And then at just that last mile, I would sabotage myself. And at the beginning, I didn't actually notice that I was sabotaging myself. But then once I started to notice what's happening, I actually started feeling massive resistance to complete that one last thing that needs to be done for that business to turn on. And I realized that the minute this business turns on, let's say like, for example, it's a business that will bring in, let's say like, I don't know, $500,000 in a year, for example. The life change that it would have made for me, to me, meant that I had to change all the excuses I was giving everybody about why I am. I had to change what I was thinking about. Growing up, I had a lot of problems with my dad. I had to like stop blaming him. I had to do so many damn things that I was sort of like used to doing for years and years and years. And when I realized that, again, that just came from like saying, you know what? Forget about trying to get the business going. First of all, what am I feeling? And just by following that emotional flow, it takes, and Casey, to be honest with you, this is not easy the first time you do it, because the first time somebody practices this self-awareness, it's difficult because most of us are used to not being self-aware. We're used to like dodging, escaping. It could be through anything. It could be through just talking or overworking or watching a lot of TV, whatever. We are being conditioned to stuff certain emotions down, okay? Or to stuff certain feelings about ourselves down. So to turn that around and to open it up and to allow those things that you've been told, don't feel this, don't think this, and to allow yourself to feel that and think that, that is what starts to make you realize, I'm addicted to this place I am because of X, Y, Z. And maybe a part of me knows that I have a lot of potential. I could do great things. Okay, there's that part. It's telling you, you can do all these great things and you actually go for it. But then there's a part of you that is just, it's formed an identity. This is who I am. This is what the world is. And no matter how far, it's like that horse. The horse has formed an identity. I'm safe in this corral with this cowboy. As soon as it starts walking away, it may be a good life out there in the bush. But because of that identity is formed, that idea that I'm a horse with this cowboy, I'm a safe person here. And that's just a very rough example, but we all have identities that we form, belief systems about what we are and what the world is. And this is the only thing that sabotages us. There's no, according to what I've seen, there's nothing mysterious out there. It's just, again, it comes back to who you think you are, what you think the world is. And that's something that you learn from when you're a kid growing up. And it's usually so under the covers, you don't even realize that you've got it. And the only time you realize that you've got it is when you're willing to completely open up your emotional system. Emotions are really energy in motion. and they're containing data. And if I want to just give you an example, a quick example, just imagine somebody that you may know who is very emotionally blocked, and then imagine somebody that you may know who's very emotionally wide open, okay? Have you noticed that the emotionally blocked person, there are certain opportunities that they don't see, or certain, you know, they can't connect. There's so much they miss because it's kind of like they're sucking life through a little straw, you know? Whereas the person who has an emotional system that's open is, you know, it's got like a big pipeline, okay? So the more you open up yourself and allow yourself to go, to take your emotions where previously you didn't let yourself go, the more you discover what's in there, what's underneath, what, in other words, what your belief is about you and the world. And the more you do that, the more you see those things that you had hidden, the more they drop off and release you and let you go. Because, for example, take this for example. Have you ever had a friend come up to you and tell you like, oh my God, Casey, I'm so messed up, you know, I think I'm so messed up because X, Y, Z. And then you go and look at them and it's like, are you crazy? You're such a cool person. You're the coolest person I've ever known, you know, whatever. And then your friend looks at you and goes, you know, there's something that triggers. They see themselves in a way that they would never have seen themselves unless they let you, you know, they talk to somebody. That's why talking to somebody really, really works well, right? So in the same way, I find that so many of my clients are in such a hurry to manifest things. And they could be struggling for 20 years to manifest, let's say, like a particular one thing. And if they just stopped and, first of all, accepted themselves where they are, how they are at that moment, and then they allowed themselves to feel those things that they're trying to dodge, because quite often some of the things that are manifest is, you know, is a whatever. And they stop trying to dodge that. All of a sudden, they start to fall in love with themselves. They start to know themselves. They start to open up. And when that thing opens up, all of a sudden, that drama that was necessary to keep that shit bottled up is no longer necessary. And then the manifestation happens like that. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that manifesting is as natural as breathing. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to learn it. It's just you breathe, you manifest. That's normal. The problem is that we're in our own way, and the way to get out of our own way is to know ourselves, because that's the only way to change how you vibrate. It's the only way that I know that you can change how you vibrate. You know thyself, just know yourself. Know yourself deep. Just keep knowing yourself.
Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Well, I know that the group there is on a really strict time schedule, but I would love, I know that there's some other people on here too, and I have a couple other questions that I'm just going to ask you that are out of that book club, but I know that they're on a strict schedule. So do you guys, I'm going to unmute you guys.
Okay.
All right, Lenny, you guys there?
Yes. And
how do we go, David, as far as, do I just get everybody's email, or how can we, for the gifting of that awesome program that you're talking about? For the, and then if somebody wanted to, I just wanted you to talk, John, because I know you said you were going to give them a video out of that, but if somebody wanted to buy your whole program, how could they do that?
I'll give you a link later on, and a whole wall with a bunch of sample videos, like 2-3 hours worth of videos, so they can watch it for free and understand what it's about. I just realized that... Thanks. I just want one quick one. I just realized I didn't complete answering your question. Please just give me 2 minutes. You asked what's the difference between emotions and feelings. I just realized I didn't finish that. First of all, I don't think there's a big difference when it comes to what you call something. For example, it doesn't matter whether you call something the subconscious or the unconscious. It doesn't matter. What matters is the mechanics of what you're talking about, right? So I find that emotions are your body has chakras, okay? It's got these energy fields. Okay, and it also has meridians. It's got channels, just the same way you've got blood veins. You also got like energy channels that move energy all over you. And as this energy is moving through your whole system, that is what you feel as an emotion. It's just energy moving through you, and it's got information. And when that information is translated, that's what you call an emotion. It's just the emotion is just a way to tell you what's the information behind this energy flowing through you. Now, I find that as well, that aspect of ourselves that we call the higher self, you know, the part of us that still knows without a doubt that it is part of source energy. Because, you know, our ego kind of pretends that it's not, and, you know, a little victim, whatever. But there's an aspect of us that has never forgotten that. Now, it has a 360, and when it wants a message to you, it's always passing on a message to you. You feel it like an intuition. It's kind of like a little feeling that you get for a split second. And if you're open, you'll catch it and you know, oh, I should call Casey. It's kind of like an intuition. I should call Casey. You know? So this is what sometimes I refer to as a feeling. It doesn't matter whether you want to call it a feeling. I'm just, it's, you know, I didn't find another word there. So that's that intuition from your higher self. And then the emotion is energy system that is you as it cruises. It's always cruising. It's always moving. It's always changing. So I don't know whether that clarifies anything.
I love this, the energy in motion. You know, I think that that's a really great way to explain it as far as the vibration. I love it.
Yeah. So what I've done is because of the difficulty that I found in explaining some of these concepts, because a lot of the things that we're talking about here, they're multidimensional, you know, they're beyond linear. And a lot of them are things that either you have to see, you have to watch, it's difficult to speak about them. So that's why I took about a year and a half off just nailing down that subconscious revealed program. And I tried to look at what's out there, and I realized that what we are being taught is in small bits and pieces. Like, for example, one person might teach us the law of attraction. Somebody else might teach us how to be emotionally open. Somebody else might teach us something else, you know, small little bits and pieces. So it's kind of difficult to put all of that together within us so that we can know what's really going on in the world. What are we really made of? What's the world really made of? How does that whole machinery work?
Have you guys lost too? Hold on, I'm gonna unmute you guys.
Yes.
Yeah, you guys.
Yeah, we lost him. We lost Dave.
We will let him come back. I know you guys are.
I'm just saying this so that you understand.
We just lost you for a second, but I think you're back now. I can see your
screen. Okay. All right. Okay. I think some people have some questions.
I know that they're on a schedule and they have to break. So I know that they have to, but yeah, a lot of us are going to be on here and asking you questions. Go ahead, Lenny.
Can you hear us?
Yep.
Everybody get up. We're going to do a standing ovation with the house lights on for David Gicondi. One, two, three.
Yay, David.
Thank you so much. I hope I did a good job. I promise you the free viewing was.
Yay, so David.
Thank you so much. So
we were so grateful for you and your work, and we're going to be spreading wealth consciousness, joy consciousness, and abundance consciousness to the whole world.
Thank you so much. And I'll get those videos out to you. They'll clarify what I've been trying to say, because it's a little bit difficult to explain what I've been trying to say verbally. So the videos are going to be a whole lot better. I'll get them out to you through Casey.
And we're going to get you to come to the U.S. for our next Bliss Retreat.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
We're going to log out. Let's keep going. Right.
Bye, everybody. Love you.
And then, I know, depending on how much time you have, David, just does anybody on here have questions? It's on our book club. Does anybody want to ask David anything?
I'm open. No problem.
Open. I got the questions that were in the group that I can go to, but I just want to give anybody that's on a chance live. we're forever talking about things, and now we got the master himself.
Yeah. Oh, I'll ask something.
Yeah,
can you hear?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yep, loud and clear.
So, David, I was wondering about in relation to other people, because we're all doing this reality for ourselves. But then, how much does other people affect us? I guess, you know, when we're in relation to this world, and then especially for you coming from like a whole culture, like cultures are doing this to each other too. So
yeah.
So how are we affecting each other?
So amazing. So amazing.
Thank you.
So much.
Thank you so much. I think the way we are affecting each other is directly proportional to how much of our authority that we give away. Because quite often I find that many of us may not understand how sovereign we are and how much authority we do have over our own sovereignty. So we tend to give away our power. And that, you can have two people, and those two people, you throw them in the middle of, let's say, like Somali or whatever. And they'll have two different realities come out of that, depending on how they believe. Again, it always comes down to the self-view and the world-view. Always, what you believe about yourself, what you believe about the world. If one person believes that they are supposed to obey authority without questioning, and that their own thoughts and their own feelings don't count, obviously their surroundings are going to affect them a lot more than somebody else who doesn't really give away their own their authority away or their power away. But what I do find as well is that environments condition you even before you have a chance to realize what your environment is about. So if you're, let's say, born in a rough neighborhood, you know what? Cambodia once. This is quite interesting. I was in Cambodia once, and I met a guy who was there with Princess Diana. And up until he was 28, you know, Cambodia had one of those crazy genocide wars, just like Rwanda did. And this kid grew up thinking the whole planet was like that. And he only realized that the world isn't that mean when the American GIs landed and he saw a TV in one of the helicopters and he saw, you know, a TV show from the rest of the world. And he was like, what? You mean not everybody is fighting? So that kind of a person, before they even have a chance to understand that the world is not violent, they've already been programming themselves. So yeah, we do get affected by other people, but at the end of the day, it's not your fault what happened, how you got conditioned, but it's your responsibility once you realize, to discover who you really are above and beyond the negative conditioning that you may have experienced.
Right. So just taking whatever circumstance and saying, I have my own personal power to make a choice in this situation.
Yeah, although I don't know what saying is a good first step, but I find that, you know, you can say something logically, but it's not going to register within your emotional system.
Okay.
I find that, first of all, you sort of have to, I'm trying to find a real quick example on the fly here. If you are to follow your emotion, let's say, like, for example, I'm going to go back to like the alcoholic example that I gave earlier, a child of an alcoholic family that I gave earlier. If that kid was raised to believe that they're there to be seen and not heard, they just, you know, shut up and disappear, mm-hmm. they could run around saying all day, you know, I matter, I'm important. But it may not really work out that well. But if they kind of like follow, if they first accept where they are, who they are, as they are, and they let that, they don't like sit around in the emotion and feel what I'm picking up I am, but they actually let themselves, let that emotion go, sink with it and see, what do I actually feel about myself? I have seen this one. Can you still hear me?
Yes, I can. Hello? Where'd you go, Dave? David?
He's frozen right now.
Oh.
little freeze, freeze.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Oh, yeah.
Really
okay. Can you hear me? Okay. Okay. So, I was saying that adults who grew up as a child, conditioned to believe that they should be seen and not heard, they should just disappear, you know, quiet.
Right.
It serves them more for them to settle and feel, really feel what's going on inside them, and then for them to actually, because the more they relax into who they are and they allow themselves to feel, they're going to percolate until they get to a point where they realize that the sentence that they're telling themselves deep down is, don't say anything, don't let anyone hear you. You see? That is a more important recognition than for them to try and run around and say affirmations. I'm supposed to be seen. The recognition makes them think, oh my God, that doesn't even make any sense. Everybody has a right to speak. Just the recognition that it's there is a fantastic first step. And then if they now ask, they could ask, it doesn't matter, it's not a religious thing. You could ask whatever you whatever. As long as they ask for help, it could be from a friend, it could be from their higher self, it doesn't matter. It's a permission that they've given themselves to start to move forward. And this automatically starts the process of freedom. Once they get out of that place, all of a sudden, any manifestations that were going on around them that were proving to them that they're supposed to be invisible and silent will end. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, so it's more of a feeling thing, really. It sounds like it has to be both a feeling. The thought is kind of secondary to the feeling.
Yeah, the way I found this works is that a belief is basically a statement. You say, this is true. This is true about me. This is true about the world. This is a belief. That's it. Mm-hmm. And then every belief generates an emotion. Mm-hmm. And so your emotions are the most reliable indicator of what your belief system is.
Right.
And the minute you see a belief that you didn't see before, you start to gain freedom from it, especially if you're like willing. You just have to be willing. You don't need to figure out or know how you're going to change. You just have to be willing. Especially right. If you're willing to release, all of a sudden, because now you've seen it, you're willing, life just starts to transform.
Yeah, cool.
There are ways to make it go faster or slower, but you know, it starts to go. And once you're free of that little system, then the manifestations happen.
Yeah.
But it doesn't, what I found, it doesn't really help to try and manifest and visualize as long as that little vibrational system is still there.
Right.
It's not gonna, yeah.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, thanks.
Okay.
That was perfect.
All right, Ms. Vasquez, you're unmuted. I know you have a question.
Hi, David. So awesome to talk
Hi,
to you.
Hi, Cindy.
Yeah, you.
Good to see you.
I think you did actually explain when it comes to sabotaging and the fear of, you know, like the horses, the wild horses that you were talking about. Once you're tame, you're there, and then you want to get out. That's, in other words, that's your comfort zone. So I guess now my question is going to change, because for me, it's still fear, still a challenge. But I've been so awesome that you're talking about now that we got to know ourselves on a deep level in order to really succeed what we call life here on earth, right? As an energy entity that we are, because I totally love quantum physics and I'm learning little by little, thank you to your book. So I learned that the reason why I don't take the leap and I have that fear is because I do not desire to hurt anybody else that is around me, which I know there's love or I love, but then I'm screaming that I have to, for example, right? So why is it that we continue to do that? You know the step, you know the action, but then in turn, you bring in the guilt, meaning if I leave, you're not being grateful for what, you know, they have done for you, for example, or the opportunities, for example, or you might hurt, you know, I don't know, people around you because you took that action. So I guess that will be part of sabotage. So I just figured that out actually last night.
do you mind if I ask you a question? You don't have to say precisely who, but if you want, you can say who you believe you're going to hurt and how do you believe you're going to hurt them? And by doing what? What are you going to do?
I won't say, you know, specifics, but then it has to do with relationship, for example. And I also found out myself that since I am in the process of a recurring people pleaser. So yeah. When I first said yes, I was actually pleasing. So I lost who I was, meaning I hide who I was, who really I was and what I believed. So now that I've been learning about the law of attraction and everything, which I knew through metaphysics in Spanish, I was introduced to it from a lady from Venezuela back in the 90s. And I just knew about it. I just knew how important your thoughts were even then. But I just hide all of it completely, everything.
Can I ask you a quick question? Mm-hmm. And I'm not attacking you. We just want to find a quick solution, isn't it? I mean, right. That's what you want, right? Yes. Yeah. So when why do you believe you're pleasing people? To be accepted?
Yes, because I know I don't want to do it, but then if I don't, then they're not going to like me or they're not going to be part of me. And it's either one thing or the other. I really want them in my life for whatever reason that is, you know. Let's say, for example, so I'm going to say yes, 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 which I already learned in the hard way that has got me in huge trouble for saying yes.
Okay.
Or not being true.
So let me ask you, if you said no, what do you think they would think about you? That you're a terrible person?
Yes.
So, do you think, I don't know whether you see where this is going. I don't know. I don't know your situation, so I don't want to try and pretend that I know your situation. But just using other people example, I know somebody who, actually several people who, they believe, how can I say? It all comes to that self-worth and understanding or not understanding that you're worthy regardless of whose opinion and XYZ. And what I feel, what you believe you're worth, not in terms of money, but am I worth a good time? Am I worth acceptance unconditionally? Am I worth love unconditionally? Am I worth safety unconditionally? Am I worth, because if you find somebody who's like, I'm not worth safety, acceptance, whatever, X, Y, Z, unless I earn it, then again, the quantum field, the vibration proves that. Like it never fails. There's no way to shortcut that system. Life is always going to mirror what you believe you are, what you believe the world is. So I guess for you, what I would suggest is to I got an exercise that kind of like asks you to write down what you believe about yourself and the world in all different aspects of life, everything from relationship to sexuality to X, Y, Z. And as you're doing that, because you're writing, it sort of like exposes what you call your story, the story that you tell yourself about you, the story that you tell yourself about the world. Once you see your story in writing and you look at it, this pretty much predicts what you're gonna get next year, the year after, whatever, as long as that story doesn't change. It doesn't matter how much effort. The story is mirrored by life. And once you see the story, if you're willing to change it and you give permission to change it, the first thing you have to realize is that you're going to end up going into the cave that you're afraid to go into. You're going to face your biggest fears. And when you face your biggest fears, at the beginning, they might be like, no, I don't want to go. You know, like when you pull a puppy to get a shower and he just doesn't want to freaking go, you know. But once he's got the shower, it's like, oh, that's so nice. I love this shower. You know what I mean? But you still have to cross that bridge. There's no shortcut. You have to just face it head on. You have to be open. You have to be willing. You have to understand that you're going to have to feel things that you didn't want to feel. And this is the only way you're going to... Because on the other side of fear is just yourself.
Yeah, sure.
There's nothing else on the other side. It's just you. So it's just all about willingness. And look, if you believe you're going to hurt people, and if you're going to get hurt, because as well, they like to keep you. And I'm not saying they're trying to do that, but people, you can sign a contract with them. They know you for the person that if they call you, hey, Cindy, do this, you're going to do it. And all of a sudden, if you're like, no, because right now I want to be doing this, then of course they might be like, what are you doing? You know, it's not your responsibility. They're responsible for them. You're responsible for you.
Sure.
So, but you just have to be brave enough to try that. And at the beginning, it's hard, but over time, it gets easier.
Yeah, I can understand that now because I started without even knowing that we're going to have this conversation. I started actually since last week and. Yeah, those fears. It's, I have prayed.
Yeah, everybody has it. Yeah.
Let me run away. Let me go into my Alice in Wonderland. That's why I love that movie.
Everybody has their own set of drama or whatever they have to do. And there's only two ways out of it. Either you stick with it for the rest of your life. Your choice, or you can say, you know what, no matter what it takes, no matter whatever, this you know, draw a line in the sand, and that's it. We're dealing with this. I'm open for whatever it's going to take. And it might even take you to places where you have so much fear that you feel like you're gonna lose sanity or whatever, but you'll be fine.
True.
It's just fear. Just let it go, you know, because quite often we dodge the fear because if you notice something about fear, it's always like in the future.
Yes.
And it's like, I want to dodge this because I don't want this to happen, okay? But the minute you just go like, okay, hit me. Let's see what's going to happen. Then you notice, I ain't dead yet. I'm still okay. All of a sudden, this thing doesn't freak you out anymore. And then it might still happen again, but this time you'll see it coming. It might still happen again. But this time you'll be like, I know I'll survive, no big deal, it can happen. And then one day you realize it ain't even happening. Where did it go? What?
Yeah. Thank you so much. That really answers it clearly. The whole emotion of it.
It's all about emotion, and I don't know if I did a good job enough with a big group because there's so many angles, but I hope at the end of the day I've come to realize the emotional indicator is the way.
No,
figure out what's going.
It was great. I completely understand now the importance of emotions and understanding and being aware and still accept. So I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Excellent. Miss Melody, Melody, you had your hand.
Hey, everybody.
That was awesome.
Where'd David go? I lost David.
There's David.
Oh, okay. Hi, David. Hi. Well,
hi, Melody.
Pretty much answered a lot of my questions. I'm with there with Cindy too, and it's kind of.
Sorry.
Are you there? What am I doing? Thank you. Anyway, it's kind of, and I'm just being very transparent, very authentic. It's kind of funny you went with the alcoholic family, and I'm 69 years young, and it's a lifetime of people pleasing and everything else. But the thing that I'm listening to today is to stop and dissect who I am. You know, just, I'm so busy being this person that, and I am a happy person. I really love people. I really do. But I believe I've had a facade for so long. I've played this role. I probably would have been a great actress, but I've played this role for so long that I didn't find out who Melody was, and at 69, I'm starting to try. But the part about writing down, so you want us to just start writing,
what we're feeling about fear or what we're feeling about. Can you elaborate on that a little? It's like I need to be reborn, David. It's like I need to start all over, even though I'm 69. I need to start all over because I'm with you. If it's my last breath, I'm going to the sand. The line in the sand is there, and I'm going to keep on keeping on until this gets right in me, because I just feel that there's somebody I'm supposed to touch a life. There's somebody that needs to see something and say, dang, this works. It works, you know. So all the insecurities and feeling of not worthy or just all of that stuff is just junk. And I'm just working diligently, believing yeah. to get rid of it.
Yeah. The thing about the writing down, I was just giving one way to do it to Cindy. So it's not like writing down is good because it gets it out of your head. So it's on paper and you can see it. It kind of like gives you that space. But I'm a bit reluctant to use the word get rid of it because what I find is that the best results come from when we stop trying to escape and dodge. And the change will come by, it will happen. It will happen automatically. But you don't have to figure it out and get rid of it and kick it out and all that mm-hmm. sort of stuff. In fact, that sometimes just makes it even more. It is more to, for the lack of a better word, it is more to, when you love yourself unconditionally, that's the answer, but that's a problem as well. Yeah, how do we do that? But that's pretty much the answer. So just think of it, the logical conclusion to that, to love yourself unconditionally means you have to accept yourself unconditionally first. So that's the very first step. You just have to accept who you are, where you are, as you are right now. Not like, oh, I wish I had more money, or I wish I wasn't here, or anything. That's the very first step. And then when you do that, then you can, that allows you to start to, the questions that I was suggesting to Cindy is actually a bunch of questions that I have one of the videos on, and it takes, it just makes it easier for us to kind of like reach self-realization, because it takes all the different areas of our lives, everything from how we relate to others, how we relate to ourselves, how we relate to source energy or God or whatever you want to call it, money, sex, everything, you see. So by asking yourself certain questions and seeing what feelings come up and writing them down, it's a quick way to see, again, remember, you're trying to see, what do I believe about me? And what do I believe? The mere act of recognizing is so difficult for most of us because we just run around life thinking, can you talk just stopping your feelings until the point where you see, oh my God, I believe I'm, let's say, crap in this or whatever. That's already such a great step. And then what you tell us. So I guess you're looking for a single method, and there are methods out there, and I'll probably share some of them with you through Casey, but I just want to say that the very first step is to accept yourself where you are, as you are. That's the very first step. And then follow your emotions and see what they, like for example, let's say you meet somebody. Let's say like, there's a time back in the days, I used to have this anxiety when I meet certain people. So let's say I meet somebody and I get this anxiety. Instead of like trying to mask it and wipe my sweat and put my shirt up, I go, okay, I'm really anxious that I met this person. Why do I have, you know, and you listen, why do I feel that? Ah, I feel that I'm not that, you know, they're up here. Why? You know, and you just listen to yourself. Ah. You see, So these answers come up and you start to understand, this is my belief system.
Exactly.
That's the key to transformation, basically. So it's not like trying to dodge and mask it with stuff.
Exactly. Very good. Exactly. And that, and you hit it right in the head. We mask it. Or I mask. I can't speak for other people, but exactly. I masked it. You know, I dodged it. I was trying to dodge bullets, but anyway, that excellent.
We all do. And there's a free video that I'm going to, it's part of the samples that I've got, and it's 53 minutes long. And I have a few clients that took it, and it's a shocker because this is a really powerful one. It really, you give yourself permission to just go all out. So if you're willing to go all out, this video will literally, because this is the point, this is what I'm trying to get at, Melody, yeah? There's an aspect of you, I call it the divine self, okay? There's an aspect of you that knows you're perfect as you are. There's this mask you're talking about is...
Oh, you froze out.
Conditioning as you grow up. This perfect, your divine self incarnate walking on this planet is going to have to get rid of all the masks. If you're willing, that's the most powerful exercise I know, and I'll give it to you for free. It's 53 minutes long, but it's like, that's like, if you want to go crazy.
Thank you so much, and thank you for your time, your precious time with all of us. It's just a blessing meeting you. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're ready to go crazy. Kay, did you have your hand up? You had your hand raised. Did you have it up? Did you want to ask? I'm going to unmute you.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, I typically don't ever ask questions. I just participate. But I was really drawn to this because I pretty much, you know, have learned, like, you know, I read The Secret, and then this book just took it to the next level. And there are a few other books, and also, like, you know, just this whole quantum physics that I'm being, you know, introduced to, and I try some of them. And I think what really struck a chord is that certain things happen and then others just don't, you know, manifest. And for me, I just want it all. I just launched, you know, my business, and you know, I was so scared to do it, but I did it anyway. And every time after I do it, I'm like, huh, that wasn't so hard. And then the next phase of fears, you know, come around. Like, is it something that you just always have to overcome? And to me, it's both in business and in personal relationships, both intimate and just with people. Like, I've gotten better, but the whole thing you were talking about, sweating, not feeling comfortable, or just even asking questions, like, I would have gone away not asking, but something in me told me to go ahead and, you know, and ask, because I definitely want to be in a loving relationship. And so I'm like, well, what am I pushing away? And I wrote a lot of notes on my iPhone that I'm going to have to go through, but I least I can say I have a little hope, but I just kind of wanted something that I can take away from, like, you know, that I personally asked.
What I would say is that I don't know what you've given us a good start. Explanation there, but I don't know what you're very particular. So what I can say is that, yes, a day comes when you no longer feel, have to go through the fear again and then again and again. There is a day that comes that happens. Ooh, it's really hot over here. The day that comes and you don't have to go through those. Now, the fears are happening. Again, I would say, can you hear me? The internet seems...
I can hear you.
Now I can't.
Now I can't.
We'll let it reset a second.
Okay, we're back.
Yeah.
I would say while the fears are still happening, can you? A more specific example of a fear, for example, do you want to use the one that you may not have asked the question? Do you want to use that example? Should we use that? Can I use that?
Sure.
Okay. Why would you, let me ask you this, why would you stop yourself from asking a question?
Because I just, I'm hoping someone else will ask the question so I don't have to.
No, why not you?
I'm trying to be behind the scenes. I'm trying to hide.
Okay.
What's the whole?
I don't know. This is a public thing. I'm a little bit cautious to ask certain questions.
No, go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Why do you feel you shouldn't ask? You see, I'm trying to get to the why. And it's not your fault, or there's nothing wrong with anything that you say. It's all okay. That's the first thing, that there's, it's all valid. You know, you're not wrong.
I guess it's like, you know, growing. It's even growing up, like in class.
Okay, I can't hear anybody.
I can't hear.
Okay, now I can hear you.
I don't know, like the same thing, like where before I ask for something that I really want.
Who that was. Okay, you're saying.
Yeah, I have I don't know what it is, like I just get this uncomfortable feeling and my mind just races whenever I have to ask for what I truly desire.
So we're getting somewhere. That's perfect. We're getting somewhere. Okay. I can't give you an answer because the only way this answer is going to come from is allowing yourself to go. Look, in a nutshell, it's all about self-awareness. Again, so you say your mind races, you feel crazy when you have to ask for something that you need. My guess, and I don't want to put words in your mouth or, you know, to assume that I know what's really going on because I don't. My guess is that there's an idea somewhere there that... like when I was growing up, I remember being told when I was very, very two things. You won't amount to anything, you don't have any insight, you know. So for the longest time, I was afraid to share my ideas because I thought they were incorrect. And I didn't quite figure out why I was afraid to share my ideas because I thought, if I say something, people are gonna laugh and I'll keep quiet, whatever. But when I stopped and I said, hang on a second, why do I feel afraid to tell people what I'm thinking? And I said, let me feel how it feels like. And I felt, oh, it feels like they're gonna laugh at me and they're gonna think this is rubbish, you know? So I realized, oh, so I actually believe that my stuff is crap inside. You see. Why do I feel and you see this continuous allowing yourself to settle into whatever you are or you're thinking you are at the moment and just go deeper and deeper, you go all the way down to a root idea. And sometimes you might even find out where it came from. It doesn't matter, you don't really even need to know where it came from. But it's important to see what's the root idea that's making me feel all crazy. Because before I was just feeling crazy, I was like, I want to say something, I'm like, you know. Yeah, but then I started to realize, oh, because it's because I think it's crap. whether, you know, whatever. And so I was like, okay, fine, let me test it out, you know. So I'll come up with some ideas and share them with people who are not the people that I grew up with or that, you know, that I got that idea from, you know, other people. And they'll be like, oh my God, this is amazing, this is amazing. I'm like, oh, really? Why is it amazing? And then soon I started to understand that my work or my ideas are very valid and they're cool. I mean, they could have a lot of mistakes, but still they're all right. And besides that, there's a feeling that they're not. You see, I finally started to separate the two. I started to see there's a feeling, that whatever, but the truth is, it's like this. And then with that awareness, the next step happened. And that was, if I can remember, this was a while back, if I can remember correctly, the next step was to, if I'm not wrong, it was to understand where I got this idea from, like that my stuff is not valid. And then, oh, so I remember now where that used to happen or whatever it was. And then I started to think, oh my God, so it was only two people who thought that my ideas are valid, or three people. This person, that person, that person. Why? Oh, they always think everything is not valid. Doesn't matter where that comes from. You see what I mean? But, you know, it could be different for you, but it's about stopping to escape and stopping to try and fix things, whatever, and first just following that emotion to a point where it gives you a sentence, like, I am this, or the world is this. And that starts beginning, you know, the healing or the recognition of, you could even say where you're sabotaging yourself or where you believe stuff that you don't need to believe, you know?
Right.
Does that answer the question? Does that make sense?
Right. So is the, like, you know, when I start thinking that I am, is the I am the positive thing or is it still the discovering process of separating where I got the belief from and what the reality is?
It's not a mental process.
Okay.
It is actually, it's quite literally allowing yourself to feel and then you sort of follow that emotion and see, you could say the sentence, this is true, that is creating that emotion. Do you understand? Like I can see, says, hang on a second. Yeah, not knowing what it's about, you feel stupid, and then you'll be judged. Yeah, so for example, I don't know, somebody's joined Bishop's comments. How's this reading joined Bishop's comment? For example, if let's say I use my example. Let's say I wanted to say something, and then I stopped myself because I thought it's nonsense, yeah? It's not about intellectualizing, yeah? It's about following that, oh no, I'm talking nonsense again, that feeling all the way down and seeing what it says about you. It's not an intellectual thing. In fact, that's a problem. We intellectualize. I don't know how else to explain this.
I get it.
Yeah. It's more about allowing yourself to feel the very thing you've been avoiding to feel.
Right.
And letting that carry you to a place. And in that carrying, it's going to land at a sentence. So it's going to land at an idea, a concept about yourself, about the world.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I have a question.
Thanks.
In your book, you talk about sponsoring thoughts and a sponsored thought. Does that ring a bell for you?
Yeah. And pretty much that's what we've been talking about.
Right.
That's when you follow the feeling, you get the sponsor.
Right. Would that be like saying something like this though? Like example, you look in the mirror, right? And you say, oh, your first thought that you have is I'm fat, right? Or something, or oh, my cellulite or something like that. You know, you have this judgment and you say I am something. So is that the sponsoring thought or would that be the sponsored thought? Like what would that I am be? Like if I looked in the mirror and said I'm fat.
Okay. I understand the question. And again, I would say, you know, when you're writing a book, you sort of have to find words so that you can arrange ideas so that you can communicate them.
Right.
It doesn't really, you don't have to get hung up on what it is. The point is this, when we look in the mirror and we say, oh, I'm fat, that's kind of like that's the conscious process going on. That's the first level of thought. You're conscious of it. You actually just look in the mirror and say, I'm fat. You know, you're conscious of it. Uh-huh. Behind that thought, there's so many other layers. For example, do you feel good that you're fat? Do you feel bad? Do you feel nasty? Do you feel ugly? Do you feel okay because you're fat? See what I mean?
Right.
And if you feel ugly or nasty, okay, and behind that, this could be another idea as well. You see what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm. So the whole I am fat thing, the conscious thought, is just proving an idea that exists. You see, if you believe fat is ugly, and so you look at yourself in the mirror and you go, oh, I'm so fat. It's just an evidence. What I'm trying to say is that the physical reality is always a mirror to let us know what we consider is true about us and about the world. So if you believe I'm not saying you do, but let's say you believe you're ugly and the world should not look at you. When you look at yourself in the mirror and you go, oh, I'm fat. Okay, fine. But why? Why is that concerning you? Where does that take, you know, do you actually believe you're not cool because you're fat, or you're ugly because you're fat? And I could be mistaken, but as far as I know, it's very difficult to get that weight until we realize and accept and truly love ourselves first, because then there's no need then to get that fat to prove that you. Does that make any sense, or am I talking in circles?
No, yeah. So it's, well, you cut off just a tiny bit though, but you said that the most important thing is what? It was like right, the last thing that you just said.
The most important thing is not whether you're fat or not, or I suppose we're using this example and it's not really. I think the most important thing here is to understand how you judge yourself because you looked at yourself in the mirror and said I was fat. That self-judgment is the most, most important thing, because once you can understand that you're looking at yourself in a negative way, whether it's because you're fat or whatever it is, and you can come to a point of understanding, oh my God, I'm criticizing, I'm looking down on myself or whatever. And that becomes a thing that now you're willing to change and to understand that you're worth it regardless. That's the most important thing. And once you've done that, you may or you may not lose the weight. I think it's a lot easier to lose the weight once you've accepted yourself as you are. But that's the most important thing, to see where am I looking at myself as something that is compromised or broken or not good enough. So whether you want to call that sponsoring thought, I don't think it really matters. The idea is, do you believe you're compromised or you're broken in some way or not? That's more important. Okay.
And then, two, I think my biggest aha moment in this entire book was that the present is just a present moment and how you hyphenated it. So you wrote, you know, P-R-E, -S-E-N-T. So basically, yep, all of our thoughts at every single moment, that's why the future, you don't have to live in it. And it's just because every single thing, or how you were saying, you're just constantly manifesting, just as we're constantly breathing. So every single, yep, thought that's influencing feeling or vibration, we're just presenting ourselves our entire mirror based on every moment.
Yeah, yeah. Pretty much, basically, that's how it works. And that's why I'm so excited with going through that subconscious module, because I got to break down again to explain what you just said. You know, when we talk about beliefs and we mention that word beliefs, we don't really sit down to think what is a belief, because at the end of the day, okay, maybe we might even go down to understanding that a belief is what we believe is true. Okay, about what? About us and about the world. Okay, fine. But why does it then work? Why does a belief produce a result? Okay. And how do I put this? again, I've hit one of those walls that only a video can actually work because it's gonna be visual. But yeah, the world is always a mirror of, you cannot experience something that is outside your belief system. Your belief system not only attracts, because beliefs are thoughts, thoughts are electromagnetic entities. They not only attract what they are saying this is true, but they also filter out everything that they say this is not true. See? So even before you walk into a room, let's say you walk into a room, I don't know, guys now have gone for a break. Let's say you get out of this room that you're in now and you go to some room. Maybe you're in a hotel. I don't know where you guys are. Some of you guys are, I can see. But let's say you walk into a room where you've never been before. Your belief structure is going to predetermine, even before you walk into that room, what you're going to recognize about that room. How you're going to see people. How you're going to treat them. Am I making sense here? Your belief system has already pretty much predetermined, even before you walked in, basically what's going to happen in that room for you. Nothing is going to happen outside of your belief system. Everything is going to be contained within that belief system. So that's what I meant by you've already pre-sent yourself that future moment. What's already here right now, there's no need fighting it, because that was a result of belief system from before. The best thing you can do is use it to learn more about what you think you are and what you think the world is. Just use it as a present. It's a present that is there to tell you what's going on inside me. You know, what do I think? What do I believe? So instead of fighting the present moment, accept it and use it to know yourself, because you sent it there through your belief structure. I don't know whether that makes sense.
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Makes perfect sense.
Okay.
So grateful for all these insights. Does anybody else have any questions? Before we met Mr. David. But what time is it there, David?
It's around 9:40 p.m.
But it's the 23rd, correct? The 23rd?
Sorry?
The 23rd, the date?
Yeah, let's see. I don't know. Yeah, the 23rd. And then on Wednesday, I'm going to Thailand, and then after that, I'll go to Sydney. So probably the next time we talk, it will be a different time zone.
Yep, always.
Yeah.
All right, guys. No other questions? Hold on, Cindy. All right, you're unmuted, girl. And then we'll have Christine. Hold on. All right, you're unmuted.
I have this quick question. aha moments all the time. It's so awesome.
Okay.
You know, about manifesting me, and I realized that that's what I've been desiring to create money so I don't have to rely on nobody.
So just say again. Sorry.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Cool. I was saying that I just realized listening to you when it comes to manifesting money, because that's my desire. Ultimately, honestly, my desire since I was a child was to have it all, materially speaking, but not only that, being able to teach this to everybody else in Spanish, English, and even in other languages, having someone, you know, translating it. So, as you said, when you are, you have to go through your fears, you just have to go, right? So, that's still my desire. So now, to set myself in the now, in this moment, whatever it is that it's happening, right, and learn for myself, how you focus to manifest that, even though you have that in your heart, I mean, you have it, you know, you feel it, the emotion, right?
Yeah.
And so how can you block everything and just freaking manifest it?
I get you. I mean, it's crazy. It frustrates you like nuts. You're like, why is my stuff, right?
Yeah.
The good news is every time you have a desire, the instant you have a desire like that, it's already manifested. That's the weird, crazy thing about all this. There's not a single desire that you have. It's, again, it's about the physics. The minute you have a desire, it's kind of like a chain reaction. You cannot have a desire that has zero effect. It's already manifested the minute you have that desire. It's already done. It's only that. Now, if you can, oh, I love the way Abraham, you know Abraham Hicks?
Yes.
She's got a brilliant way of explaining this. She uses an example of a river. And so, you know, a river flows down, okay? Now, she says that the problem is that, let me try and phrase it the way she says it, is that we roll uphill instead of just letting go and allowing ourselves to go downstream. So she says, and I agree with her, that the soul, that entity, that part of you, whatever you want to call it, the higher self, that is already in the knowing of what it truly is, the reason why you're here is to have contrast, and from that contrast you have a desire, okay? And the minute that desire is fetched, the soul has already manifested, it's already there. So the problem is like, your resistance is the one that has not caught up with that soul. So it's not that the thing hasn't manifested, it's that you've got other things telling you, and I'm not saying this is what happened to you, but you've got other things telling you, for example, if I'm going to have to teach, I'm going to get, you know, have to get on stage, I'm going to have to speak to people, but I'm not good enough to speak to people, whatever. You see what I'm saying? So these other little belief structures, I gotta just turn off. These other little belief structures about us. Do we want to be visible or not? Do we think we have something worth to say or not? These others are also manifesting at the same time. And this is what you experience as not having or time taken. You get what I'm trying to say? And that's what I was trying to say when the group was here, and I wish I could, and it's still a little bit tricky for me to say. It's not about trying to manifest something. It's about trying to get out of your own way. And though you get out of your own way, is you follow your emotional system, allow yourself to feel stuff that you didn't want to feel, because then that shows you the belief structures that are actually in the way. But the minute you have a desire, it's already done. It's not like you have to put an effort.
That exciting. It's just like
all this other crap is in the way. Is that making any sense?
Totally. Yes, very much sense. Yeah, that's where I get.
Yeah. And you're 24/7, you're vibrating. So, you know, we keep thinking, I just want some goals. I'm going to teach people this stuff, and I'm going to get everything. Blah, and then down a level, whatever. Oh, I hope my boss doesn't see me wearing. You know, all that shit's making stuff. It's not like dead. So that's why it's such a journey about, it's more about knowing yourself. It's all about, yeah.
It goes back to that. Cool. I got it.
Yeah, because you're always vibrating. It's always about 24/7. Yeah.
Yeah. Makes sense. Thank you. I just had
Thank
to.
You.
Thank you. That was a good question. That was good stuff right there. All right, Miss Christine, you're unmuted.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah. Hi, Christine.
Hi. I just have a real quick question. I've been getting emails about your videos and stuff. Is that what you're going to be? Is that what you're going to be putting in the group for the link? It's the subconscious reprogramming series.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I'm going to do, and I got to talk to Casey about this because I want to figure out the best way to provide that. But the reason why I made those videos is because of the question. Simple question: why does the law of attraction not seem to work? You know.
Yeah. Okay.
So I realized that actually didn't realize that.
I lost you. Anybody else here?
Hello. Let me just.
Yeah. Okay. We're going in and out.
Try and find out if there's a way. Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yep, got you now.
Yeah, okay. So you're trying to figure out how do I... This video series basically is my attempt to put the law of attraction in context with everything that's around us, from our bigger reality that we see, all the way to the little things that make us, make up everything that we see, to who we are as human beings. Even perception, for example. You don't realize how much perception is a part of what we think life is. For example, if you're, you know, back in the days when people thought the earth was flat, and they thought if they went to the edge, they'll fall off, so they didn't go to the edge. So perception itself is a part of the, you know. So the subconscious modules are just an attempt to try and capture as much as possible all the things that make up the human being and the life that we live in. But yeah, that's basically it. Because I found that when we get little, when we get an explanation that is incomplete, and we get like just an explanation, for example, like the law of attraction works like this, and then you don't have an explanation of, let's say, like, okay, fine, but how did I get conditioned in the first place? Or why is this other stuff happening? Then it seems to, you might think that, oh, law of attraction is not working for me. It is, but it's just that there's this other stuff that wasn't talked about. So that's just the attempt to look at the whole big picture.
And I guess for me, and Christine, I don't know if this too, when you get in that, or like the things you're like, well, how is this happening? I didn't manifest this. Like, that's not what I was wanting. But it's almost like that's the thing, though, that is going to take you to the thing that you want. It's just, you don't, we don't know it at that time, you know, if, even if it is a negative, it almost like, you know, was the positive, I think, is what I've started to realize too, just from being able to manifest a lot of things, you know, recently. It's like, yeah. Huh, looking back at it, it's like, oh, that was the thing. Like, I didn't know it at the time, but like, wow, that negative was actually the positive. So
yeah, you know what, I love what you say, because I've come to realize two things from my own life, is that regardless of what happened, every single day 24/7, even the stuff that I thought was so not cool, all of it, if I'm open to it, all of it leads me towards the resolution of knowing who I am, so I can expand even the worst stuff. Yeah. As long as I don't resist in fighting, it's always taking me to a place where I know myself more, so I can expand. When I fight it and I resist it, then it just keeps looping and repeating itself over and over and over. It could repeat itself for 5, 10 years. But the minute I stop and I say, I don't even understand why this is a blessing, but it is, and I see what's it teaching, telling me about me, and I stop, all of a sudden I can find that I've got a resolution in a day. And another thing I notice in my own life is that until we recognize it, quite often our predominant manifestations are recreating the feelings that we had when we were younger. It's like the feelings that we got used to, our manifestations recreate those feelings, or, you know, they keep us within that feeling zone. No matter how much you try, it's like the horse and the corral.
Love it. I love those explanations. That is epic. Joy just said epic explanation.
But the good news is, once we realize this, all of a sudden we start to get the doorway out. Because that's the point of this conversation. It's not just to talk about why do bad things happen. It's by understanding why, then you get the door open. See, that's the point.
For sure. Love that. That is epic. Anybody else have a question? Well, I am just so full of gratitude. You're like, truly, I mean, this like is like people's like Bible that they're using. They're around, and we love it so
much. Thank you so much.
Oh, it's just, and then just the audio that people can have too. I mean, it's just everything. I think it just, I've never read a book that's explained it the way that, you know, you have. And I know we're just all so grateful to you and taking your precious time. And I know that
it's my pleasure. That's what we're here for, to serve each other.
Well, we are so, so grateful. And if you had I know in the book too, I think often you say it's just about meditation and exercise with, and how does meditation and exercise, because this is kind of a challenge that we're all doing, is to move daily and to meditate daily. How would you say important those two things are on a scientific level of what happens, and then we'll
I find that exercise is the easiest one to explain, because when you get your body moving, again, it's just part of that whole unblocking the flow, the energy flow and all that, you know? You don't want it, you don't want your energy to get stagnant, whichever way, whether you're not exercising is another way to block your system, in short, you know? So it's just, you know, the body needs to move. Everything about life is motion, motion, motion. And the more you move, the more you get flow going. And the more you flow, it's like when you block an emotion, you're stuck. When you unblock it, it flows, you're going through data. You learn A, B, C, and it keeps moving. So it's the same thing with motion and exercise. When it comes to, you know, and also it's about feeling good. Because again, that whole downstream thing is looking for a better feeling place all the time. Can you hear me? It says, okay, the internet is back. Meditation, let's put it like this, hypnosis. We all know that when you go, you know, when people go under hypnosis, they get to reveal their own subconscious. And hypnosis, to be honest, is just about relaxation. That's all hypnosis does, just relaxes you. When all this noise is gone, and now you can really hear what's going on under. With meditation, it goes out, and then you start to get in touch with subtle things that you didn't notice were there about you. And I find that in life, the most subtle things are the most powerful things. So I think that's how they help.
Love it. Miss Teresa, Miss Wood.
Yeah, hi, I had a quick thing. I live in Montana, and I put on health fairs here and have some speakers come. And I have a friend that is having Amit Goswami come to speak. Nice. Are you familiar with him?
Yes, and, I've never spoken with him, but yeah.
Anyway, so I was kind of wondering if you have a contact person, like a PR person, if we ever wanted to try to get you to come speak here.
In Montana, in the U.S.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. This is going to happen very soon because, like I mentioned, on Wednesday I'm going to Thailand. Then after that, actually after a few weeks, I'll go to Sydney. I haven't really, it's only with this new program that I've just released that I've really started to do this, I could say, full time. Before this, I was doing real estate, and I was kind of doing this just kind of like a side hobby. So as soon as I get there, I'm setting up the whole, because right now all I have are tech people and support guys. I don't really have an organization to do this. So what I did is like I put up my shares in my real estate sale, and I'm committed to this. But at the moment, no, I don't have a PR person.
Okay, so maybe I could just through the Facebook group put out a message to you about that.
Yeah, sure. Through Facebook or I didn't realize I could actually type. There we go. I can type my email address over there in the chat room. And once we get to Sydney, whole organization is going to be set up for that. And we can coordinate these kind of things.
Okay.
Question.
Great.
I think we would all, yes, it's time to manifest David here in the U.S.
Thank you so much. Give us a great
group. All right. Thank you so much. Any last words that you want to say? We're just so grateful.
I just want to go back to that same idea that it's always all about vibration, because I find that we forget and we keep trying to look for a trick here, a trick there, and the quantum field is just a scientific thing. It's like the way magnets attract each other. It's all about vibration. So the best thing you can do for yourself, again, is just to follow your emotions, to figure out, are you vibrating, why, blah, and that's a transformation that then and locks the gates that may have been keeping from manifesting whatever you're trying to manifest. And that's probably the trickiest thing I keep finding when it comes to making clear, because it's just such a tricky thing to explain. But at the end of the day, when you finally get it, and it's just purely about vibration, it's not about this effort or that trick, so many things change. It's just that I find it a little bit tricky to get that point across.
Love it. What's the best ways that you find to keep yourself in, like, if you could say, like, all right, five things to do to keep your vibration high, what would be five tricks to kind of, like, if you can feel your vibration based on your feelings, you know, something happens, you let yourself go down that tricky road. It's like, whoa. Yeah. My emotions are telling me something. How can I, you know, I recognize it, but then what can five things that I can do to then raise my
I think the first thing is, again, self-acceptance, unconditional self-acceptance in the here now. Authenticity, that's obviously a part of self-acceptance. Which means you need to be emotionally vulnerable, which means you need to have your mind trained not to dodge, you know? It's undefeated, it doesn't try to dodge, yeah? Because if you notice, everything that I've just mentioned has to do with being in the present. Have you noticed that all those things that those four or five things that I listed, and you are in the present moment, and that's about it. There's no secret trick, really. It's being open. It's understanding that you do want to end up feeling good, not feeling bad, but you. It's kind of like one of those paradoxical things. Like, yes, I gotta go. I want to feel good, better and better and better. I want to stay authentic. So if I feel like crap, I own it first. Yeah, I feel like crap. And understand that, you know, not by theorizing, but by watching it. And in that watching, as you accept yourself as you are, and being authentic and being emotionally open, you know, mind is not trying to dodge, you will automatically, in that aha moment, you'll be like, now I finally understand why I do this. And you'll feel good. I don't know. It just, at the end of the day, it just sort of keeps you in the present moment. I don't think there are any super secrets. It's just that we try and dodge bullets. That's the problem. I think.
Like, there's not secrets. How Will Smith, in that one video that I've watched, he goes, he's like, you know, it can't be that simple. And he's like, it can be. It's that simple.
I haven't watched that video. If you can send me that video, that's cool. Yeah. Is that what Will Smith said?
Like, it can't be that easy. Yes, it can.
It actually isn't that. It's not rocket science. It's we just complicate it because we're trying to dodge and hide and duck and, oh, I don't want to feel that. I want to be seen like that. And that's all that stuff. And instead of relaxing into where you are, you're like, I don't want to feel this. Oh, something. Like, let me manifest another mask. This is what makes it complicated. But it's actually not that complicated. It's you can summarize it in one word. Relax.
Relax. And just do it.
If you had to use a word, that would be the word.
Relax. When you relax from the flow. All
if right. You had to.
Awesome. Well, just full of gratitude. I just so grateful. This just meant so much to everyone. I mean, we just study your book every single week. It's just really transforming a lot of people's lives. So many aha moments. So you're definitely spreading wealth consciousness. So the floodgates are open for you. Oh, we lost you. Hold on.
I think what I'll do is I'll email you.
Okay.
Okay. So what I'll do is I'll email you a link, Casey, to the I'll send about 4 videos that you can then post on the group and maybe the links, and that'll help. Because if you can tell the group you're on, I have a feeling I didn't do a very good job explaining this authenticity part. It's such an important part in manifesting. Yeah. So I hope the videos and the whole, because at the end of the day, what we do is we manifest the story that we tell ourselves. That's the problem. And so at the end of the day, what we need to do is to understand that story so we can change that story. It's not really about specifically going, I want to manifest a car and I want to manifest $10,000. It's about the story that you tell yourself about what you are and what the world is, and changing that story. That's what really makes the mega shifts, the big ones.
I like it, the mega shifts.
Yeah.
Holy shift. Awesome. Well, this is also recorded, so I know that they'll watch the rest of the recording.
They're okay, that sounds cool.
They're going to watch this too. And then, yeah, just send me those links, and I'll get it to the group, and we're just so grateful. So thank you so much for your time, David. I'll unmute everybody. We can all just
thank you, guys.
Love.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Yay, David! Thank you so much. Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Have a beautiful rest of the day, guys.
Amen. Thank you, David. Bless you.